Thank you very much for the invitation. And I am Giuseppe. I am a child neuropsychiatrist. And I've been working for many years with dyslexic patients, ADHD patients, and I have used psychophysiological tools to understand how this, the brain of these children work. I can start saying that when Hans Berger, in the beginning of a century, discovered the EEG, he named this device thought device, thought recorder. The challenge, the wish, was from the very beginning to connect thought, thinking, and brain, and electrical activity of the brain. This wish was not realized fully later on until the introduction of the computers. Because mainly the EEG was used for diagnostic purposes on neurology, mainly epilepsy. And because it was only visual inspection. From the other side, we started to know about the function of the brain with the work of Penfield. Penfield in the 50s and eminent neurosurgeon. And he was stimulating the brain for therapeutical purposes and recording the activity on the awake patients, the reaction of each stimulation of the area. So we started to know and to connect some activity, some behavior of the patients with the specific brain areas. But this was accomplished only because he had the possibility to open the skull and to record the activity, mainly for therapeutic reasons. From then, another field of study was accomplished by the most eminent neuropsychologist, the father of neuropsychology, Luria, in Russia. He studied many, many soldiers wounded during the Second War, and only with the pencil and paper, testing this subject, he was able to describe the function of each area and its deficit. Coming from neurosurgery, from neuropsychology, but still, brain and mind were two separate things. Mind was the domain of psychoanalysts and brain of neurology. Only the introduction with the computers, with the fast analysis, was then possible to link some brain activity with the behavior. And later on, with the functional MRI, it was possible to confirm what Luria already saw with paper and pencil with his patients. So from one hand, there is nothing new, apart from some new technologies or new tasks that can fully describe the activity of the different areas. But now the link between brain and the behavior is much closer, and nobody now can react or can say that there is no link between brain and behavior. So this talk today will deal with some aspects of this behavior in children with attention deficit and hyperactivity disorder, and children that have ADHD plus oppositional defiant disorder, to see the characteristics of their QEG, and also to describe the personality of these children with the temperament and character inventory, as it is described by Robert Cloninger. He presented a psychobiological model of a personality. And following this challenge, after the description of the characteristic of the personality, many studies have tried to correlate the temperament and the character with some aspects of functional neuroanatomy. Then I will talk, I will present what is the personality profile according to this model of ADHD children, the results of this questionnaire, the Junior Temperament Inventory in these children, and then I will present the correlation between this personality inventory and the QEG of these children, and which area are specifically correlated with some aspects of this some aspects of this personality of these children. And in the end, we can I try to show you what are the implications of such studies. According, so we can start make a definition, no? What do we mean for personality? One very simple definition is the way how people learn and adapt. And it's very simple. It's the what we see is the effect of learning, of experience, and how a human being adapts himself to the external and internal world. Or another definition was the self plus the internal and external forces that pull the external force on the self. Again, is a kind of these forces that shape the personality of a subject. And Cloninger defines a personality. He added another important aspect, is a dynamic organization within the individual. And added also another word that is a psychobiological systems, because it's a personality definition is based on biological data, neurophysiological data, genetic data, and the biochemical with the studies of neurotransmitters. And all these systems shapes and adapts uniquely to an ever-changing internal and external environment. What are the key features of the personality of this definition? As I said, they are dynamic. It means that they are non-linear. They are adaptive continuously, not linear or fixed. So it's continuously changing according to the various situations and contexts. They are psychobiological because involve the body, the mind, and the intuitive creative mind, so thought, soma, and psyche. This is the integration. It's a model that takes into account all these aspects in a dynamic way, not to fix it. And also is organized because there is a universal, a more general structure shared by human beings that allows us to understand each other and to communicate each other through this general system. And also, in addition of this general system, they are personal. It means that there are processes, adaptive processes, that occur within the individual and not between person, because an individual has to adjust himself to the demands of the environment. And of course is ideographic, because each person is unique in the development of their life. It has your own experience, and this is what makes the difference between each other. Taking in mind these features, that I repeat, they are dynamic mainly, and so non-linear, he presented the model that the personality is made by two fundamental characteristics. One is a temperament, and one is a character. The characteristic of a temperament is that the reactions driven by temperament are unconscious, are automatic. They are innate, genetically based. The character, on the contrary, is something that is conscious, is a self-aware plant. It's determined by education, by culture, how we have been educated. This is a shape, the character of an individual. And of course, they interact each other by meaning and by silence. Temperament is related to associative conditioning. As I said, they are genetic, they are innate, they are conscious, automatic. While character is related with the propositional learning, has a conceptual insight. And there are four aspects of this temperament that are relevant for describe the full personality of a human being. One is called harm avoidance. The other one is a novelty seeking, reward dependence, and persistence. These are the four characteristics of the temperament. We will see later which are these characteristics. So harm avoidance has to deal with the passive avoidance, novelty seeking with activation. Reward dependence is a sign of a social attachment, and it remembers all the attachment theories. And the persistence is related with the reinforcement. The aspects of a character that are conscious, they are self-directedness. So it is related with the individual, the capacity of the individual to organize himself towards some goals or aim. In a more complex system, the other aspect of a character is a cooperativeness, and it's related how I interact with other people in the society. And then the other aspect is a self-transcendence. So it's related to how I feel myself in the universe. By combining all these aspects, they of course interact each other and made the personality of a human being. These what are the basic emotional predisposition of temperament? Those who have a high level of novelty seeking, they are impulsive, irritable, craving. So there are people who look always for novelty, because in this way they feel much better. The people, on the contrary, they have this low level of temperament, they are rigid, and they are more prone for internalizing disorders. Harm avoidance, high level of harm avoidance, it's people anxious, depressive, more prone with internalizing disorder. Or, on the contrary, these are with people with low harm avoidance are risk-taking. And this low level of harm avoidance, mainly it combines with the high level of novelty seeking. I'm not able to jump down with the airplane with the parachute. I don't care if it is open or not, I will go down. This is people with a low level of harm avoidance. But I like the challenge of fall from the airplane. Reward dependence, as I said, is related with the affection. And people with a high level, they need the continuous reward, they are sociable or rejection sensitive. No? Or if they have this low level, they're aloof, they call. Especially these people, when the reward is unstable, it may come or may not come, they become very anxious. And they prefer to withdraw, no, and not to interact. Persistence, the other aspect of a temperament, people with a high level of persistence are very ambitious, are perseverating. When they set their goal, they are stubborn, they insist in order to achieve their goal. Or mothers with their children with a very high level of persistence, they are nearly obsessive with their children until they do the things. On the other hand, low level of persistence are phlegmatic, inactive, easily discouraged. All these aspects are dynamic. We have different levels. These are the only two extreme, and we will see later. The aspects of a character that is related with the higher cognitive function, and in other words, with the mental self-government, are related with executive function, the self-directness. People with a high level of self-directness are responsible, purposeful, and resourceful. Exactly the contrary with the low level. Those related with the society, we know the level of the society, are related with the legislative functions. So people are flexible, helpful, and compassionate. So how they cooperate, how they establish a relation with the people, how they are able to work together to form a group and so on. And the self-transcendence is related with the judicial functions. So it means they are people insightful, intuitive, judicious. It's also related with the moral aspects of the life, the ethical aspects of life. People with a low level of transcendence, they are very pragmatic, very concrete. When this model was after that this model was proposed, it started quite a lot of studies trying to relate these aspects with the brain functions, due also the possibility of these new technologies, because we must know that the aspects of a temperament have been also described by the other authors with the other names like fear, affection, and have been also described the cerebral circuits related with these aspects of a temperament. While the aspects of a character are more related with the frontal lobes, with the more prefrontal and frontal lobes. The aspects, of course, aspects of this system of the cerebral system of a temperament, there are part of the cortex are involved, but mainly it's the subcortical structure that predominates, like hippocampus, limbic system, and basal ganglia. All are related to very complex systems. The question was, are these seven factors of the TCI biological distinct? Because each dimension has a genetic causes, each dimension has a specific brain circuitry, has a unique role in information processing. In particular, the TCI dimensions of temperament have a strong non-linear relation with the specific parts of the brain involved in the processing of negative emotion, habits, and motor abilities, while the TCI dimensions of a character have a strong non-linear relation with those parts of the neocortex enabled for the processing of facts, proposition, but not for negative emotions and habits. It was, and it is, always difficult, and the correlation between structure and aspects of the temperament is not so high, because the interaction is non-linear. And so you have to use very specific task that stimulates that particular area of the brain or particular aspects of a temperament with a specific task, and to see which regions reacts exactly to that stimulus. We know that amygdala is strongly related and analyzing the fearful stimuli or negative stimuli. It's amygdala serves for surviving. We have immediately to detect if a stimulus is noxious for us, and we have to react or to fight or to avoid. And this is a principle, the role of amygdala. And we have seen for example, harm avoidance, those people who have a high level of harm avoidance, there is a strong correlation with the perceptual processing of fear stimuli in the amygdala. And you see here this high correlation, and this is the structure that shows this high connectivity. This is the amygdala and the anterior cingulate cortex. Another study was looking at the correlation between self, one from temperament and another one from character. There is a self-directness and you see the correlation of self-directness with the left dorsal medial prefrontal cortex, how are very highly correlated the
the level of self-directness with the activity of this area.
So this was an example of the functional neuroanatomy that it says that we can really examine aspects of character and temperament and correlate with some specific structures of the brain. So I will present now what is the derived from the literature and our studies also, what is the profile using this questionnaire of ADHD children, how they look at the children with this questionnaire. They look in this way, they have high level, is hyperactive and hyperactive children with attention problem and impulsive problem. They show high level of novelty seeking. How they look? The child has the tendency to activate himself in response to new stimuli or signals of approval or potential punishments. It implies the necessity of elevating the levels of stimulation, the tendency of exploration, enthusiasm, but easy to boredom and impulsivity. He or she is messy, people unstable in personal relationships, and has a sudden bursts of anger. He or she is exploratory, impulsive, extravagant, excitable, and irritable. On the contrary, they have a low level of harm avoidance. So it means that they are bold, disinhibited, daring, outgoing. And what this characteristic implicates? Implicates the lack of a concern for the possible consequences of his or her own actions. If you ask, they say, no, it's not my fault. It's because of my parents, it's because of the teacher. The fault is always of other people. And they say, I didn't mean, I didn't want, I don't know why. And they lack of caution, oppression, and have a poor sense of criticism and punishment. The parents say, I don't know what to do. I have tried everything. Now there is a no punishment that can help. And they come to the doctor to ask for help because of their education style has failed. They don't know that these people have this low level of harm avoidance. And these are genetic. It's very difficult to modify. This is important. Because then you know you have to change the strategy how to deal with these children. Moreover, they have low level of reward dependence. They are critical, detached, with the poor emotional expression and independent. They suffer of the unstable reward, ambiguous reward. They prefer to be detached, to be independent. They have a low level of persistence. They are not able to maintain a consistent behavior in front, this is what I said, of intermittent reinforcement. Low persistence reflects the lack of perseverance, determination, and consistency. It, therefore, in front of frustration and fatigue, the child inclines to abandon the tasks. He's apathetic, spoiled, underachieved, pragmatist. And the character. The character, they are low in self-directness. They blame other people, aimless, vain, unproductive. Immaturity, childishness, lack of self-sufficiency, responsibility, reliability. They are not responsible of their own actions. They have low self-esteem and self-confidence. Cooperativeness is also low.
insensitive, hostile, revengeful, opportunistic, and disloyal. This profile, it's the summary of various literature that have used this profile. Our study, what we have compared this temperament inventory in a ADHD children plus children with ADHD and oppositional defined disorder. Combining them, as I said, with the QEG, in order to find biomarkers using both behavior and EEG that can distinguish these two groups. In the end, I will add something about this what implies this type of studies. But now we see that the oppositional defined disorder have much higher level of novelty seeking and lower level of self-directness and cooperativeness. This is what the pathology is, the oppositional defined disorder. Of course, it's not a surprise. Now, how we can now, the problem is that, as I said, that the correlation between temperament, character, and the cerebral functions are weak and inconsistent. Unless it doesn't we don't pay attention to a specific aspect of the temperament or a specific cerebral regions with its connections. The question is, yes, do we have reliable methods that can relate specific cerebral regions and of the brain and relate to temperament? Yes, we have. Now, it's not from the 1960s, we have the QEG. And more recently, with the improvement of algorithms, we can not only see the brain maps, but we can locate the sources of this activity, specific brain activity, with the specific brain regions. It's called the 3D sources evaluation of the brain. And if we do a simple test, very simple t-test of the QEG, we see that at 1.9 Hertz, the ADHD children have a lower level of activity in this area, and in comparison to ODD, in the delta band and in the alpha band at 9.7. On the contrary, in the theta and the beta band, ADHD children have a higher level of energy, of activity, in this at 5.8 and 17.6 Hertz in this band. If you look, they are mainly on the right hemisphere. But this is the comparison of the EEG between ADHD and ADHD plus ODD. And the result before is the result of the comparison between the comparison of the inventory. How we can combine
the temperament in the QAG. How we can do it? There is a very very complicated statistical analysis that is called stability-based biomarkers identification. I will try to explain how it works. We have to select all these variables of the QEG and the 7 variables of the inventory are randomly selected, 70% of the variables and 70% of the subject. Then it's applied this method called GLM net classification method. This method selects the most significant variables and retain the classifiers, the variables that have been selected. And this position is repeated more than 50% of the time. And then it's created a classification equation. After it's created a small subset of this 70% of the subject. And this subset is calculated the area under the curve. And it's retained also, and only the classifier that satisfy the 10, 20, and 100% of a false positive are retained. And then it's calculated again the distribution of the area under the curve, and the value at the 50% of each distribution is retained as a stable. And look at the number of variables, there are 1,000. It's necessary to reiterate this classification system many times, otherwise we lose the sensitivity of this test. This method is not new, because has been already applied in classifying Alzheimer's disease, and has been published, and more recently has been applied also in cardiovascular disease, and is an optimal method to find biomarkers for classification of this disease. And one review, it's the one of Hernandez Gonzalez that tells more about this method. And these are the results of combining together the results of the PCI and the QEG. The 7 variables of the PCI, the 912 of QEG, and if you look at the results, when you analyze alone the PCI variables, the ROC curve, they are not significant. Even when you analyze the real ROC curve of the QAG, but they become significantly 0.90 when you combine both the questionnaire, the inventory, with the QAG. And what are the most significant variables for the TCI? The self-directedness and cooperativeness. We have already seen the results, no? With the TCI alone. Those two variables were selected more than 90% of the time. And so they participate in the classification position, together with the novelty seeking that was selected 70% of the times. So these are three variables are very significant, together with F4 and F8. Those two electrodes are very significant in delta, theta, and beta bearing. the area that are covered by these two electrodes, F8, F4, are Brodmann area 9 and 10 and 45 and 47. Just what this area do? Area 9 is involved in short-term memory, attributing intention to other people, evaluating recency, and overriding automatic responses. Remember the aspects of the temperament. They are automatic. They cannot be changed. And Brodmann 10 plays a major role in the highest level of integration of information coming from visual, auditory, somatic, and sensory system. This is the tertiary areas described by Luria, when all the stimuli are integrated in a modal way, and they form the abstract thinking, and then there is a conceptual interpretation of environment. So that maybe the Brodmann area 10, the anatomical basis for the suggested role of the prefrontal cortex in influencing abstract information processing and the integration of the outcomes of multiple cognitive operations. So this area 10 is very important to make a judgment for criticism. And these children, both the DHD and ODD, they lack of this kind of, or it's almost imperative. They are not able to attribute intention to other people. Area 45 is also it's mainly involved in processing semantic processing of language, cognitive control of memory, and facilitate the logical analytic reasoning of performance. All these aspects are related with aspects of character. And area 47 process is involved, implicated in processing syntax, oral sign languages, and more recently in musical syntax. But this is not enough. As we said, this is, we know the electrodes, we know the area. But if we can, we now have the possibility to analyze the E and the other, if you average, then you can mask those significant voxel activity. Then, if we reduce to 67 regions and multiply for 49 frequencies, they are the one that we selected with the very narrow band analysis, we come up with 3,000 variables. So still it's a lot. How then what we did? We looked at the literature and we find out what were the most regions implicated in a DHD and ODD. Then we decided to concentrate on that specific areas to see if we could see any difference between these two groups of children. So in this way it was possible to make the ROC curve. And what I said, we used this a priori knowledge, and the most implicated areas were the frontal orbital, gene frontal, and the prefrontal, the cingulate. And we included also during the classification procedure those areas who showed the higher regression values when the groups were compared. So then, reducing in this way, then we come up with 604 variables. And of course, the 7 of PCI were also included. And then we saw that doing in this way, not using the raw data, the raw values of the QEG, by using the Z-score of the sources, we had the most significant at 10% and 20% of a false positive. And the stable rock, very stable and more significant when we added also the Z-score after the sources, 0.7, 0.8, 0.9. And here have the regions. Again, the variables that were selected from TCI were a novelty seeking, self-directedness and cooperativeness, and the sources. Now we know not only that it is F4, F8, now we know exactly the sources are the lateral orbital frontal, the medial orbital frontal, the singular regions, angular gyrus, the inferior occipital, the occipital pole, the insula. And those are the peak frequency that were abnormal in these areas. So the area that generated these abnormal peaks in each band frequency are those illustrated on the left. And if we now go to the functional anatomy, we know what is the function of the human orbital frontal cortex. The researchers support that the main disorders associated with the dysregulated orbital frontal cortex connectivity center around decision making, emotion regulation, and reward expectation. Exactly the aspects of the temperament described by Clottinger. And these are low in this kind of children. A meta-analysis of existing neuroimaging studies demonstrated that activity in the medial part of the orbital frontal is related to monitoring, learning, memory of the reward valuable reinforcers, whereas lateral activity in lateral orbital frontal is related to evaluation of punishers, which may lead to a change in ongoing behavior. ADHD has also been implicated in dysfunction of a neural reward circuitry, controlling motivation, reward, impulsivity, including the OFC systems. The singular region, it's the integral part of the limbic system and is involved with the emotion formation, processing, learning, and the memory. The simulated GIS is highly influential in linking behavioral outcomes to motivation. A neuroimaging studies show that separate areas of anterior cingulate cortex are involved in cognition and emotion, and therefore it can be proposed as an interface that integrates the traits of temperament with those of character. And this integration 5 minutes, yes. I can use, yeah. The angular gyrus. Angular gyrus reacts. No, sorry. React differently to intended the consequential movement. Recording the discrepancy, the angular gyrus maintains and awareness of the self and contributes to maintain self-directedness. The insula is involved in consciousness and play a role in diverse functions usually linked to emotion or the regulation of the body's homeostasis. Significant positive correlations are observed between scores of novelty seeking and the cerebral blood flow in the orbital prefrontal network, particularly the right anterior and the posterior insula. Now, to conclude, why all these studies are useful? First of all, to study better the comorbidity. Now, in medicine, when we say comorbidity, it means that we are talking about two separate conditions that are not related. Now, ADHD combined, no? And ADHD plus ODD, can we speak that it's a comorbidity that it's independent, or they are two different diseases? And we can distinguish these two diseases by these biomarkers. So then we have to revise the concept of comorbidity in ADHD. We are talking about different entities altogether. There is a kind of relation between these two. So first. Second, it can be useful to investigate the entitling the various clusters of ADHD. These are those clusters that the literature says that ADHD children have a different type of QEEG, of cluster of EEG, and they react differently to treatment. So with using this method, we can improve this classification. We can use this data to monitor treatments. You see here the difference characteristic of those who respond positively to treatment with atomoxetine after 1 year of treatment, and those who here do not respond to treatment. So can be easily used for monitoring this therapy, and beforehand to provide information which are the subjects that can, what kind of treatment I can choose according to the classification of the QEEG. And in the end, to improve the scientific knowledge, because with the other kind of examinations, we know that the frontal, temporal, cingulate, caudato, cerebellum, and the striatus are involved in the ADHD. The difference is that they have shown with the functional MRI, very, very expensive tool, and very difficult, and these are mainly from adult studies, very difficult to apply these techniques in ADHD children in an fMRI environment. Very easily with the 20 minutes of EEG, you can have the same results, and maybe also better. So in the real conclusion then is that we represent a new and original approach to associate individual differences of personality and behavior to specific neuronal systems and subsystems, provide a powerful tool to help the clinician to formulate a diagnosis, and open ways to new therapeutic opportunities that are also non-pharmacological as neurofeedback. And thank you for your attention, and I would like to thank also the Krugman group that has made all that is a very excellent truth to me, particular statistical analysis. Thank you very much.